Welcome.
I'd like to introduce the President and CEO of Pacific Community Ventures, Volvo Gupta. And she's going to lead us throughout this 1 hour again with insightful information, positive information, useful information so that we can all move our business forward. Thank you, everyone. My name is Vijay Lamont.
Thank you. Thank you for warming us up and getting us ready for this conversation. Always love having you on and the range of music you play. Look forward having you close us out later too. thanks everybody for joining us today for our Small Business Support Circle community event. My name's Bulbul. If you don't know me already, I'm the president and CEO for PCV. And I'm really pleased to be joined today by my team that's helped put this together, Nathalia and Morgan and lots of others behind us. And also this great panel that really resembles the community that we serve and that we've brought together. DJ Lamont is the owner of Fingersnaps Media in San Francisco that he mentioned. And he also, what he didn't mention is that he also does DJ and media arts lessons to both kids and adults in his studio and after school programs. And he's been working with our business advising program since about 2016 to do both more marketing strategy and work schedules with his team. And it's been really fun to have him in the last couple of community events we've put together. We launched the support circle a year ago because we knew that as we entered the COVID shutdowns, the COVID-fueled shutdowns in our small business communities and main streets, that our businesses would need not just capital to keep their businesses open, but support of all different kinds, which is really what our advising program has been set up to offer as well. And we knew we would need to bring more stakeholders invested in the success of those communities around them to keep that support going. And now, 1 year in, we continue to bring together folks to really commemorate the incredible hard work the community has done to keep showing up, as well as to celebrate the resiliency in our community. I know that can be a challenging word sometimes because we feel like over the past year, we practiced more pivoting and resilience strategies than most of us probably knew we had inside us. But it's really a testament to the emotional and mental effort we know it takes both for our small business owners and those of us that serve them. I also want to acknowledge that folks are showing up from all different parts of the country and many of which, you know, have been affected by especially recent events in Atlanta, Boulder, on top of everything else we've gone through this year. So I just want to acknowledge that is very much, we're here for it. We're here for all of it. And I think that addressing that is very much part of the kind of support we hope to continue to offer. We launched the support circle in September, around the 6 month mark of the shutdowns, because we wanted to really make sure that we were continuing to be able to meet the needs of the small business owners throughout the longer term crisis at that point we knew we were in, with support from Kaiser Permanente to really help us get going, as well as founding partners like Ibaltsi, ICIC, and a lot of Black and BIPOC-led CDFIs and partners around the country, including other CDFIs like us, like Hope Credit Union, LISC, and accelerators and incubators like 1863 and others, as well as offering it through the California Rebuilding Fund that we launched with the governor's office around Thanksgiving. Now we come together to also welcome new Small Business Support Circle members who've joined us in September to continue to help us ramp up the needs in our community around finance, digital marketing, HR, and so on. And those include some of the folks you see here, GoFundMe, Workday, Intuit, Charles Schwab, Cisco, so many more partners, Bank of America, as well as other community partners like Center for Community Wealth Building, Urban Leadership Foundation, Appalachia Community Capital. So it's really nice to see the range of partners that have continued to show up through the support circle. I wanted to just give you a quick sense of what we've done in the last year through the support circle that we continue to build on before we enter into the panel conversation that we're excited to be able to bring today. When we look across the impact that our support circle and our advising program has been able to offer in the past year, we knew that we wanted to be able to serve the most affected and underserved communities to be able to fulfill our mission, frankly. So we're proud to be able to say that 83% of our small business owners reached have been both either women or minority-owned businesses. And that's really a testament to partnerships with organizations like Justine Peterson, 1863 Ventures, which both work with Black or women entrepreneurs. We've hosted over 20 webinars. I think we do, feels like we do one almost every week or every other week, but those include a range of educational sessions, advisor trainings, office hours, so many different things, QuickBooks, menu planning. It's been such a range of needs this past year. And over 700 participants, thanks to collaborations with, you know, SF New Deal, Wells Fargo, and starting with our first cohort of crisis response advisors last spring that we brought together to help some of our small business owners in the immediate sort of shutdowns and pivoting when the word pivot became really popular last spring. And the last couple of things I wanted to just mention is we've also really ramped up our ability to serve monolingual folks, small business owners who needed support in Cantonese specifically, with our partner Ibalsi, in Spanish specifically, with our partner ICIC and others. And that's definitely something that we continue to innovate and expand across our work, as well as geographic expansion. This is the first, 2020 was the first year where our business advising program served more businesses outside of California than inside California, which really continues to be a testament to the partnerships we're laying out across the country, including many through Kaiser Permanente's networks, and their local community partners, including Urban Leadership Foundation in Colorado. All right, so with that energy, I would love to introduce you all to the panelists joining me today for our conversation. To kick off, first we have Kim Wilford, the General Counsel for GoFundMe, one of our newest partners. We also have Ariana Macau, owner of Zalani Glass Conservation, who first joined PCV in 2016, I believe, and has worked with several different business advisors with us around her website, marketing, contracting, HR, and I'm really excited to have Ariana's voice with us today. We have Jessica Holguin, director of the Center for Community Wealth Building in Colorado, one of our newest community partners. Akiva Lewis, who is the Principal for Diversity Business Partner for Workday, and first joined PCV in 2017, I believe, working with a couple of our different business owners through our advising program during his Google days before now joining us from the Workday side. Really, really happy to have you all here. Thank you so much for taking the time to join our community and to be able to share both why it's been part important to you to be part of this community and what inspired you to join the support circle. Kim, I'd love to kick it off with you, if you don't mind, and get a sense for what it is that you feel like you've been seeing on your platform this past year that inspired you to launch GoFundMe's first, I think, small business relief program, and then join us in the small business support circle most recently. Why is it important?
So first of all, thank you so much for having me. I'm really, really excited to be here today and get a chance to speak with all of you. And I look forward to hopefully meeting a number of you. But since 2020, it's fair to say that we've seen a real rise in fundraisers relating to small businesses. We've traditionally been a peer-to-peer platform. And during the pandemic, we also saw a donation being made to a GoFundMe campaign literally every second. And so there was a real need. Suddenly, 3 of 5 fundraisers on GoFundMe that were COVID-related had to do with small businesses and people seeking donations to keep these businesses afloat and to help their employees. So we, along with our nonprofit advocacy arm, which is GoFundMe.org, we formed a small business COVID relief fund and initiative this time last year with other corporate partners, where we could bring in donations and provide a tax receipt for donors and also give them one place to donate. We had so many people in the world looking to help, but they didn't know how to help. So we brought the money into this fund, and then we would distribute it out to small businesses that had GoFundMes in the form of donations. So I'm happy to say that we've given over 5,000 grants out of this fund in the last year to small businesses, and that the fund continues to get donations, and we continue on a weekly basis to give out grants to eligible businesses. So with that, we really saw a need like this, the business use of GoFundMe just really became much more common than it had been in the past. And then being part of your circle was just this, I mean, when I first spoke to you, I was just so inspired by what you guys are doing, because it's not only the opportunity to contribute capital, which is definitely needed to these small businesses, but also I knew our employees are all heart. And I knew that if I brought them an opportunity to share their skills and spread their knowledge and their love with other people, that they would just be so thrilled by it. And I'm happy to say I've been right? We've seen a huge excitement internally about the program. And so I'm just excited to see what we can all do together.
Thanks, Kim. Yeah, we've definitely seen, I think since we launched just a few weeks ago, we've seen about 28 of your employees sign up already. And I think we actually kicked off one of their advising partnerships already.
I actually got matched yesterday and heard from some others that they also got matched. So it's happening. And we have our own Slack channel. We're really excited about it. Yeah, it's great.
Oh, that's a metric of success right there. The companies we partner with have an internal Slack channel for employee engagement where they're excited to share the success of the small business owners they're partnered with. That's what it's all about. Can you remind us, so when you think about the reach that you then have, whether it's through the grants program, the support circle you joined with us, and the mentorships you guys are kicking off with your employees, why is it particularly important for you to support women and minority-owned businesses through this time?
So, I mean, we have an active mission of inspiring hope and changing lives through giving, right? And we know that these businesses, minority and women-owned businesses, have been disproportionately affected by the pandemic. We also know that, I think more than, we all knew that they were the heart and soul of our communities, but we all started to feel this more and see this more when suddenly your bakery was no longer there or the small restaurant was no longer there, right? It just felt lifeless for a lot of people. So supporting these businesses is really something we feel passionate about, because full recovery depends on it. I think it's not just the big corporations that survive. In fact, the smaller ones are far more necessary because they create the jobs, right? They again bring life into the community, right? And then people can grow with those. And the hope is that then turn around and mentor other people. Right? So the multiplier effect, I totally dig it. I love it. Yeah.
Thanks. Yes, indeed. I think small businesses employ about 50% of Americans, certainly true in California for sure. And I'm making this phrase slowly go viral, the culture keepers of our communities, because you're right. I mean, if you think about your favorite go-to for, you know, whatever it is, like, those are the folks that employ the heart and soul of our communities and our local workers. And when I think about a culture keeper, I cannot think of a better example from our community than Ariana, who specializes in stained glass conservation. That is a fantastic way to keep our cultural heritages alive. Ariana, I'd love to turn it over to you to ask a little bit about how you first got engaged with PCV and where, you know, if you can take us back to sort of where your business was maybe pre-COVID or pre-shutdowns, what were some of the main things you guys were excited about and dealing with at the time? And we will certainly ask you to reflect on sort of how you have pivoted in the past year, but I'd love to just start with where you were a year ago and what you were excited about.
Sure. Well, first of all, I'll answer the question of how I became aware of PCV. I was part of a women presidents organization at the time, and this was a few years ago, and sort of lamenting about a few different aspects of my business, and the woman who was running it said, oh, have you heard of PCV? And I said, no, I've never heard of it. And she sort of explained and said, here's the contact information. And I just remember thinking, what? There's people who can help me with specific aspects of my company and I don't have to pay for it? What's the catch? And then I reached out, and I was first paired with someone in human resources, and you know, it was kind of, you know, love at first sight. I really like the energy of everyone in PCV, and the dedication, the enthusiasm that I'm seeing from Kim is, it's across the board. It doesn't matter what aspect of the business people are there to support you with. They're really there with heart, and they really want to see you succeed. So yes, the there's definitely a monetary aspect, but making those connections and just having someone to hear you and hold that space for you, I think is almost equally or more so important. So I don't know. I know we don't have a lot of time. I could go on talking how amazing PCV is for hours, but if you want me to now go back to where we were a year before, our company has grown. We started off, it was just me, and then I had a few people working for me. We're project-based, so sometimes we go up to about 20 people for working on really large monumental projects. Our core is 7, but we tend to float around 10, 15. And that's where we were. We just hired a couple people because we were about to embark on a large year-long project. And what we do in a nutshell is we're a one-stop shop. So we are trained, we have safety precautions. So everyone's a lead worker trained, asbestos trained, and we know how to climb up on scaffolding. So we go and get the large multiple, you know, sometimes up to 500 panels at a time, remove them from the building, take them back to our shop in Oakland, work on them, completely take them up apart, put them back together, and then go back and put them, install them in the building. So we had spent a long time negotiating and filling out contracts, and finally had locked in this amazing job, which we were supposed to be boots on the ground March 16th, which was the day that it was announced here in the Bay Area. You have to shelter in place, everyone go home. And so as a small business owner, I remember saying in the morning, okay, it seems like this COVID thing is really taking hold. If anyone in the team gets it, we're not going to judge. We're going to support the person. And, you know, we'll just keep going. And that was at 9 in the morning. And at noon, I was like, okay, everyone gather together, put all the panels to bed, go home. I don't know when I'm going to see you again in corporeal form, but, you know, my promise to you is that I'm going to, every single day, I will email you and tell you what I have done that day to figure out how I'm going to keep you employed, where the funding is, what the timeline is, and I'll just keep on emailing out to you. So yeah, that's where we were. And then you, do you want the pivot, or that's just where we were now, or I guess a year ago?
Yeah, no, I remember last January touring your workplace and going from studio to studio, looking at the different projects and glass panels you were working on, how you were talking about adding folks and this big church project, right, that you were about to embark on. And walk us through a little bit, I think just, you know, how, what did you do then beyond those daily updates to your staff? What did you kind of have to do early on? And then once you realized it was really a longer haul kind of scenario, what worked, what didn't work? What were some of the main challenges or pivots
you made? Sure. Well, for me, one of the main challenges was making sure I checked in with my team, because we don't have the ability to work remotely, or the core team doesn't have the ability to work remotely. And so I was very conscious from the very beginning that there was this kind of inherent hierarchy, right? So the management team, we could work from home, we could work on our computers, but I couldn't ask my team to, you know, build the windows ephemerally. So I really wanted to convey that to the team, that even though we had different tasks within the company, they were equally valuable, because we could hustle as much as we wanted, but if I didn't have a team ready to go once we found that job and once we came out of quarantine, it wasn't worth it. So for me, that was almost pivotal. Driving force. We have such a great team, and for them to feel valued and be heard and acknowledge that they make the team, right? I could go work for a museum, but I've chosen this type of company, and they were valued. So that took up a lot of energy, positive energy, but it's a lot of energy. And then, you know, I'm sure everyone who's on this chat, who's a small business owner, just sitting on the phone for hours. And I felt like I also had the luxury of a couple other managers where we could tag out, you know, you call this number, I'll call this number, and one of us maybe will figure out how we can get a loan, or even the website, what do we do? So early days, that was really hard. But we also quickly pivoted, because we have a strong commitment to health and safety for our employees, that we figured we could switch into being a necessary core business that could function into making masks, because we wear masks all the time for our work, our respirators. And so we designed some, and in 3 weeks, we went from not even having an idea, me saying, I have a crazy idea, why don't we do this, to making masks and having an online shop. And we knew it wasn't going to be long-term, but it was a good stopgap, and that could get the people back into the studio who are working with their hands making that. So that was the bridge. Meanwhile, I was constantly figuring out, you know, what else can we do? And we fall under art and construction because we're working on buildings. So we were able to come back in under the auspices of construction, because if you have a hole in your wall, you have to get that fixed. That's an essential business. So we were able to go back partially, but we also saw an interest, because everyone was at home, that residential people started to reach out to us, because they wanted their windows fixed because they're looking at them 24/7 instead of just walking by them. So that's another thing that we've had, is trying to figure out how do we market ourselves, because people assume we have this reputation of working at Grace Cathedral in really large buildings, that we wouldn't be interested or wouldn't want to even look at someone's window in their home. And of course we want to, because business, right? We want to do that. So that's also been a challenge, but also really exciting for us to move into this new market, for me to raise up some of my longer term employees to get their feet wet in running a job. So maybe they couldn't handle something that's monumental, a year long project, but they could take care of something that takes a month. So that empowers them as well. So we've just taken the time to anneal ourselves, to use a glass term, in making ourselves stronger and getting ready for the next step, whatever the next step may be.
Thanks, Ariana. I know CEO to CEO, how you think about your workers and developing them and building leadership skills in them has definitely been one of the things I also continue to learn from you, just in coming into my own role here. I'd love to invite in Akiva. So when you think about your experience having worked with a couple of small business owners through PCV's advising program, Was there any interaction or any, you know, stories you remember that particularly stood out to you? And especially I would ask, you know, what compelled you then to take that experience from Google and bring Workday further into working with the advising program as well at PCV?
Yeah, thank you. And it's really wonderful to be here. So I'm on my third engagement right now as a business advisor. And I have to say each one of them has really been incredibly remarkable. My current engagement is with Eric from Compete Sports Diversity. I believe Eric is part of the call today. So hello. And we've been working together for almost 2 years now, actually. And what's really stood out to me is that the issues that we've talked about have covered such a wide range of topics. So it's ranged from, you know, digital marketing to HR related hiring, development, org structure, strategy, sales segmentation. It's really been a really wide range. And I find that to be fascinating. While I have my day job, I love to be able to exercise the different parts of my brain too. And I think that the advising relationships have really enabled me to do that. And what I think really stands out to me is that this is really about, it's certainly not about me. It's about helping each of these business owners kind of work through the issues that they have. And some of them are longer term issues. Some of them are much more immediate, things that just came up that they need to bounce some ideas off of or get some different perspectives. And so I love being able to come in and do that problem solving and offer advice as we go. And so, you know, I'd say that it's not a single moment or a single instance that has really hooked me. It's the totality of it. And, you know, being able to see that growth, and you may not see it like meeting to meeting, but if you take a step back after a month or a quarter, you can, and then you can really see what we're doing. And Eric has actually been fantastic at reminding me like what he's been able to accomplish. And so that kind of keeps adding fuel to the fire for me. And then kind of going back to your to the other part of your question around like starting at Google, what got me to continue. You know, initially my engagement with PCV was around how can we form a partnership to support small business owners? Because my work was how to provide better digital marketing support to women and Black and Latinx business owners, and say, okay, what are the different organizations that can support us? We ultimately pivoted to how do we engage our sales team with volunteering? And really seeing volunteering as a key component of helping people feel connected and motivated to their mission and sense of purpose. And for me, that has certainly been true. And so even though I've left Google, I was not going to leave my engagement with Eric and more broadly with PCV. So I love it. It's honestly the highlight of my work week is to be able to spend this time. And I look forward to many, many more years of doing this.
Thanks, Akiva. What a great story. And we promised we did not tell him exactly what to say. that was really lovely. I'm on my third mentee relationship as well. And it is really gratifying to, you know, beyond just investing in the community overall, like specific challenges folks are working through month to month and just, yeah, I think that direct connection piece is absolutely invaluable. Jessica, I'd love to turn it to you to ask about the communities that you serve. So you are one of our newer partners in Colorado. Tell us a little bit about your mission and the small business communities you're working with.
Absolutely. Thank you for the invitation to be here. So Center for Community Wealth Building was started through a grassroots effort. And we initially started by talking directly with community members, with business owners to figure out where those gaps were. And so back in 2017, we heard from business owners loud and clear that the current systems weren't necessarily supporting the micro enterprises, so less than 10 employee businesses, especially if they were owned by people of color, if they were owned by immigrants, if they were owned by refugees. And so we felt that that's where we could have a significant impact and ensure that our communities could stay in place. And so the Center for Community Wealth Building was born. We worked towards a people-owned, inclusive, and sustainable Metro Denver economy that catalyzes prosperous and resilient communities free from racism and injustice. And back in 2017, I'll be honest, there was a lot of pushback. They were like, drop the free from racism and injustice. Let's focus on all businesses. And I said, you know, when we focus on all businesses, we focus on no businesses. And for so long, people of color owned businesses have been disenfranchised from systems. And so we are going to be bold, and we are going to ensure that businesses owned by people of color have access to new markets. And so it's not, I would like to think that it's not bold anymore, but we have chosen to continue to focus on those who have been traditionally disenfranchised. And so the strengthening people of color entrepreneurship opportunities became one of the main strategies. We have three strategies in the organization. The other one is democratizing ownership. We believe in cooperative and employee ownership as a pillar of our community. And then of course, engaging anchor institutions, hospitals, universities, and municipalities, and how they use their procurement and hiring practices to ensure that they're supporting our local entrepreneurship opportunities. And so the purpose of the strategy was to ensure that we're building local economic resilience and community cohesion by strengthening micro enterprises through culturally responsive business support. And so when we heard from about PCV through one of our local partners, we were really excited, because one of the things that we recognize is that there might be business support may not necessarily be culturally responsive, and so especially very lacking for Spanish-speaking business owners. And so we were really excited when we were told, you know, PCV does have some resources that you all might be able to share and capitalize on. So we know that there's so many needs that our entrepreneurs have, and we also recognize that not one entity has enough resources to be able to support all the entrepreneurs. And so we have worked at the grassroots level, but we also work at the ecosystem level. And so we connect entrepreneurs with service providers, with capacity building support systems to ensure that they have what they need. Sometimes it's us, as we directly work with the place-based institutions, the hospitals, universities, municipalities, and helping understand invoicing. But sometimes it is much more the relationship that's needed. It's through a coaching. It is about, you know, helping entrepreneurs think through some of the challenges that they're currently facing. And so Center for Community Wealth Building has been that center that we connect the entrepreneurs to what they need. You know, oftentimes entrepreneurs think that the first thing they need is capital. And sometimes that is the case. Oftentimes it isn't. It isn't the first thing they need. And so recognizing the support needed to ensure that they can get what they need is so critical. So to that end, we work with a lot of locally owned businesses. So these are the same businesses that you all talked about, businesses that contribute to the fabric of the neighborhoods, that make them rich, unique, and that contribute so much to our communities that we definitely don't want to see them lost to involuntary displacement, gentrification, or just the pressures of the current pandemic.
Jessica, I cannot wait to meet you and hug you in person someday, like speaking my language. That is so exciting to have you in the circle. And yes, it's been really interesting, I think, to also recenter our own sort of civil rights mission in this context of bringing together the economic justice and racial justice for which, you know, organizations, community development organizations like ours, collectively were meant to address, and really making sure we are actually meeting the needs of our communities the way that they need them met, and showing up with that next thing, right, when they're ready. And that's part of the, I think, beauty of what we've tried to put together as well, that it is about that support circle. Like, it is meant to bring that community together to support each other, to be bigger than the sum of any of our parts could be individually. I'd love to just understand specifically one thing. I think just when you think about how the advising program is already starting to support some of your small business owners in your community. Are there any sort of one or two examples you think in the near future might be the most helpful for how you're already putting this in place, this partnership in place?
Yeah, so we are definitely, I think we hit the ground running, and we had a session yesterday with more entrepreneurs. It's been wonderful to be able to offer yet one more resource from our toolkit. And so thank you for being part of our village and our toolkit so that we can provide the entrepreneurs what's needed. As we're continuing to move forward, I think one of the things that continues to come up is, you know, when we were supporting the entrepreneurs to help them apply for PPP dollars, for relief dollars, one of the things that became pretty clear was the need for accounting systems. And so we're in the process of identifying what are the needs of the entrepreneurs and how can we connect them to the resources needed. But oftentimes it is just, you know, having somebody to run an idea by a coach, somebody who can objectively say, yes, this is a really good idea. Oftentimes our entrepreneurs lack the social capital around them. And so they have people who truly believe in them as individuals, and they wouldn't dare to say, oh no, that's not a good idea. Let's think about this in a different way. And so some of the things that we heard from our entrepreneurs is that they need that honest question and that respectful question to be able to say, does this actually meet the needs of the business right now? Do we have the systems in place to be able to make this happen? And they said that one of the things that has been really, really helpful is being able to talk to somebody who's objective, somebody who's not, you know, is not going to break the relationship of friendship because of the feedback that they get. One of our entrepreneurs that I spoke to recently, she said, my coach is kicking my butt. Like, I at this point, and I'm loving it. But I think the other aspect that we have an opportunity right now, because we're still in pivoting moments and we're still trying to identify what this looks like, we have an opportunity to support the entrepreneurs to come out even stronger on the other side. And so as we think about the pivot, one of our other entrepreneurs said, you know, I had to pivot my business completely, but I'm now going to keep this pivot because it's proven to be very successful. And so as they continue to grow, it's going to be critical to continue to help them think through what are the possibilities and how do we continue to expand in a way that makes sense for each entrepreneur.
Thank you. Yes, I call that my build forward better. Like, we don't want to go back to an economy that wasn't working for a lot of our entrepreneurs already. How are we thinking differently about how we build forward better, whether it is structuring our capital differently, showing up and advising differently? What are the sort of products and services our communities really need to build forward better? You know, for PCV, and I heard you reference this earlier, one of the things that we think about as central to sort of how we build forward better is the more that we can help our small business owners succeed, the more that we will be able to not only support our local economies, but the workers they hire, right? That jobs effect and that economic effect that we really want to see when we think about community wealth building, that's in your name. For us, that is very much the heart and soul for why PCV kicked off our good jobs, good business work, providing toolkits like that to working with small business owners on, you know, how do they continue to sort of make those micro changes month to month, quarter to quarter, as they have the opportunities to improve the quality of the jobs that they offer. So I hear you talking that language a bit, and I hope that that's useful. I would love to pull in Ariana, who probably has the most experience on this call of working through the Good Jobs toolkit and an advisor with us on the quality of the jobs that you offer, Ariana, that you were starting to talk about earlier. I'd love to hear any reflection you might have on how that has been useful to you in the past, how you maybe continue to think about it as you enter this sort of more recovery period or set yourself up for the longer term.
Sure. It's been a really good reference and reminder, and as you said, Jessica, a butt kicker for us to think about long-term goals, because often when you're a small business owner and you want to do best, you're just so in it that, you know, having those long-term projections get sort of muddled in the day-to-day. So it's been really helpful working with one of our long-term HR advisors to help us assess which different aspects we want to use, because all of us are at different points in our lives. All of us have different life choices outside of Zilani. So I think I went into it thinking, you know, for example, like wealth management, everyone's going to want to do this. And sort of almost having a detrimental maternal aspect or lens on how people wanted to do it. And I was encouraged to reach out and ask our employees, actually, you know, what makes more sense for you? You know, boots on the ground, does it make sense to have an incremental raise, or does it make sense to have a 401k? Thinking, you know, we're project-based, and although, you know, my hope and desire is to have you, you know, hired as long as you wish to stay with this company and it's consistent, sometimes we may have to take a break or constrict a little bit. What feels best for you? So it was really nice having that as a template. And also, that, you know, kind of having a dream board or a wish board of, you know, I would love to do everything that's on that list, but as a business owner, I know the first thing I have to do is keep my business alive so I can hit all those marks. And so working with different advisors and having people ask really pointed questions as to, like, that's great, you have that goal, but how are you going to step up? You know, if you shoot too high, you may not have anything. Just having someone to bounce ideas off of within the confidence of knowing that isn't going to go anywhere else, that all your advisors are in your court. No one's going to judge you. No one's going to say that's a bad idea. They may say, have you considered this? But it's very supportive. And then, you know, one of the final things I'll say to that is when I first saw the good business list, we were in the beta form at the beginning, it was nice to see that I was doing some of those things already that I didn't, you know, it was a great positive affirmation that, oh, really, not everyone checks in with their employees twice a year to see how they're doing. That's something that I thought was a good thing to do. So what a great affirmation that, you know, I'm doing something that other people think is a good idea.
Thanks, Ariana. So Akiva, on the flip side of that table, as an advisor, you know, and maybe as maybe even a piece of advice for new advisors joining in, what should people be thinking about when they're thinking about becoming an advisor with PCV or working directly with a small business owner? Any advice?
Yeah, I mean, the first thing that I would say is that you should believe that you have something to give. You know, everybody, whether you're earlier in career or you've been around for a bit longer, like having some confidence that you have value to a business owner, I think is really critical. It's very easy to say, no, I'm not an expert enough in such and such a thing. But I think each of us have something to offer. And, you know, it's a matter of finding that right match. And having an open mind. So I would say that folks should just jump in. You know, it's a lot easier just to get in there, start engaging, and then you realize you get a lot of positive affirmations as to the value that you can offer. And so just being a neutral third party kind of puts you in a really strong position to be able to give some solid objective advice. And you don't have to be in your, you know, you don't have to be the master of your role, of your domain for, you know, 15, 25 years before you can have something to offer. So I think that's probably the biggest thing is just jump in and know that you are going to be valuable for that business owner.
Thanks, Akiva. Yeah, I've definitely found the biggest hesitancy or question people ask me in becoming an advisor is, but I'm not enough of an expert. Like, how do I help on this? And it's amazing. You realize once you get started in conversation, how much more you know about what you do every day or what you think about every day. That is actually more helpful, especially for some of the small business owners working with, you know, small teams, which is the bulk of our community, just to have that sounding board. So yeah, I agree. I think the expertise hurdle we sometimes put ourselves through is prohibitive on our own sort of self-selection out. So in the few minutes that we have, I would love to do a round, starting with Kim maybe, of, you know, when you think about why, what drove you to join this community and what you're starting to already see with your employees engaging, the small businesses with your platform, what is one piece of advice or a call to action that you might offer to others who are, you know, in this event, listening and out there to engage or to do one thing differently?
So I think, well, after listening to all the panelists, like I'm more sure than I was about how this is the right place to be to try to help a number of people. And I actually think get help for ourselves too. So as was said, like it's a very rewarding experience. I can only imagine, but the resilience that Ariana has shown, right? I think that if I was coaching you, that would also give me a lot of strength going through my personal day. So I think it's real leveling in the sense of we are all in this together and everybody wins if we all help one another. So if there's any businesses listening who are wondering, is this a good program? I think you've heard that it's a great one. And I have really high hopes for what our employees will do and what we'll learn and how we'll grow through it as we, and we also get to grow with these entrepreneurs, right? It's not one and done on your volunteer. You can actually see your impact and feel it. So I feel like anybody who's listening should participate in the program. I mean, that sounds like a really basic call to action, but join in, right? Have fun and let's all get better together.
Thanks, Kim. Ariana, what about you? What's one key takeaway or call to action you would offer or ask of the community?
Yeah, I'm so glad that you asked for me to go next because I was like, I want to respond to Kim. I would like, my call to action is that, again, it's not binary. There's this reciprocity that goes back both ways. And as I've grown in my company, I've felt like I can, you know, I'm on this panel now, I'm participating, I'm giving more. So it's not like, you know, for the advisors who may think, well, it's just a one-way street and it's just, you know, going to go off and you won't have this long-term relationship. At least for me, I've had such a positive experience with this that now I'm getting to the point of like, well, I kind of know some stuff too. So, you know, maybe at some point I can be an advisor as well. So it's, you kind of grow into it. And then also for people who are thinking about potentially being an advisor or getting an advisor, I'd like to say it's a safe space. And Akiva, you sort of touched on this as well, that if it's not a good fit, people don't take that personally either. I've worked with a couple advisors where I said, you know, the advice you gave me was great. And this month was amazing. And I got what I needed. And I want to put you back in the water so you can help someone else who's a different fit. And there was, you know, it was no harm, no foul. So, and then there's other advisors that now I can count as a personal friend that I'm going to have a friend for life. So there's this gamut. It's not all size, you know, one size fits all. Yeah, I would echo what Kim said, just get in there because it's a really great group of people.
Thanks. I appreciate that. And yes, there's no time like the present to get in. This year is going to be absolutely essential to shape whatever it is we want the recovery to look like. Jessica, what about you? What's one action you would ask of our community?
I'm a rule breaker, so I'm not going to go for more than one. But I would say if you're a business, sign up and maximize resources. Get involved. If you have some experience, volunteers are always needed. And so Business owners need advisors, coaches, and sometimes even cheerleaders. And so your support is incredibly needed right now. But if you're here from an organization or institution, I challenge you to analyze your procurement data and figure out how you're currently spending your money. Make a goal to spend your money in a local business and focus on one or two areas where you can shift that to a locally owned business or a business owned by a person of color, and ensure that you're supporting the businesses where you, as you're able to, because the change starts with every single one of us. We can't wait for large systems to change. The change is gonna have to be with every single one of us so we can start to change that narrative.
Amen, amen to that. yeah, you said it all. I would love to hand the reins over to Nathalia, our fearless head of business advising here at PCV, to close us out from PCV. And then I think we're back to the DJ.
Awesome. Thank you, Bubble. And thank you so much to our wonderful panelists. You're such a great representative of our amazing community. And this is what the Small Business Support Circle is all about. How might we all join forces to make sure our small business community thrives and therefore our general communities? So please, if you're a small business owner and you love to get matched with an advisor, check out our website. We'll get you started there. If you are thinking you could be a business advisor yourself and volunteer, please also check out our website. We'll send an email with a link. You can just get started over there. And then finally, if you're thinking that your organization can help us advance the mission of the Small Business Support Circle, be it by helping us reach more small business owners in your community or through supporting our work to expand and bring business advising throughout the country, please send me an email or reply to the email that we will send you after this event. You can just reply and say, I'm in, and we will follow up and we'd love to welcome you into this community because as you can tell, this work has never been more important. So thank you so much once again to each one of you for being a part of the community, to our wonderful panelists, and for everyone for joining. Thank you so, so much. And I'll give the reins to DJ Lamont, who's going to close us off with some inspiring music to get started.
Thank you, everyone. More music.
Thank you.
Years away, 'cause I got here on a dream. I still hear my mother praying every day. I'm an African in New York. You didn't see I'm from my pride and energy when I did walk out down the street. You can hear it in my accent when I talk. I'm an African in New York. Oh, oh, I'm an alien. I'm an illegal alien. I'm an African in New York. Whoa, oh, I'm an alien. I'm a legal alien. I'm an Englishman in New York.
And don't forget, we're rooting for you. Thank you, DJ Lamont. It's a great start to our afternoon, a wrap up for the day for our friends in the East Coast.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you so much.
Thank you.